You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, and streaming live on Ustream, this is AfterBuzz TV for the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest Real Housewives news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, picking up where the show leaves off, and the buzz continues, it's AfterBuzz TV for the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills.
Hello, everyone. Mari Fagel here. And I was so antsy and itching to discuss last night's episode that we're doing it even earlier than normal. And luckily I have Jackie Mirann, my incredible co-host, joining me. Hi, Jackie.
Hey, Mari. Yes, I am excited as well. Two new housewives, lots to talk about. So the earlier, the better.
And I have my third co-host, DJ Jesse Janity, joining me in the house.
What up? Loved the episode last night.
I know, it was so dramatic, and I'll be debuting a new segment for Real Housewives where I'll be reading all the fans' tweets or selected tweets, my favorite ones, during the show a little later on. But let's just get right into it, because the beginning of the episode was what I was so interested in, was whether Kim was drunk or what was going on. You know, last we saw, she was running late to go meet Adrienne and Paul to go to the Sacramento Kings game. I thought she was for sure drunk. And now, Jackie, I want to hear your opinion because I think you're differing from me. While watching it, I was thinking, okay, is she just kooky? Is she like total ADD, or is she an alcoholic? And I have to say, it has to be a combination of all three. I don't think it's just that she's kooky, because she was rambling so much, talking so much, so inconsiderate of like what Adrienne was going through, and so all over the place. Like, my favorite was when she was talking about, people like routine, people don't like change, and then all of a sudden she goes, oh, is that chocolate? Like, it was just totally out there. So, Jackie, is it just kooky, or is it drunk?
I have to say that I think it's just being like crazy, because I know people like this that, now I may be totally naive here, but until I see her engaging in the drinking and then having it be a reaction to her drinking, I have to side with just the fact that she may be a kooky person, because I know people like this where they ramble on and their brain's in a million directions. I don't know what it is. I don't think it's normal. I wouldn't say she's acting normal, but I didn't see her consume alcohol. They offered her alcohol. I believe it was on the plane or in the limo, and she declined. But no matter what, she's definitely some level of crazy, because you don't just like run out the door, say your hair isn't blown out. Meanwhile, it looks professionally blown out. Then she's like totally ignoring Adrienne's cues as far as what this game means to her and the significance. And you're right, her brain went like a puppy, went from what Adrienne was saying to chocolate to this to that. So there's definitely something wrong with her. But I'm not going to say it's alcohol yet until I see it, because we didn't see her drinking. And if she was getting her hair done and her power went out, you know, I'm not necessarily sure that there was alcohol involved, but definitely crazy nonetheless.
And Jesse, what do you think? Is it drunk or is it just kooky?
I don't know. I thought she was just one of those. Yeah, I'm kind of siding with Jackie. I think it was just one of those kooky little, maybe she had a little spritzer. Like, I'm not even going to lie, my mom can kind of be sometimes like that. She's going to kill me if she ever heard that. But, you know, you just drink one wine cooler and you're not drunk, but, you may not be a drinker like that and you might be off the wall, but she just, I don't think, was into the game, and she was excited that she was with her friend, and I think she was trying to enjoy herself.
And I think it was weird that she looked like she said she wasn't, like she had no power and stuff, but was I the only one who thought like she looked professionally made over with her hair and makeup when she said she had no power and she couldn't blow dry her hair?
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't even focusing on that. I was just focusing on how she looked in general. I was focusing on the fact that she had sunglasses on and looked totally out of it.
I mean, if she's a drunk, I'll say she's kind of a well put together drunk, because yeah, she was talking a lot, but she wasn't all over the place. Like, it wasn't sloppy. It was just, you just couldn't shut her up. It was like a smack to the back of the head, like, bitch, please.
Yeah, well, I think we should start a new segment weekly called Is She Drunk or Is She Just Kooky? Because we're seeing this behavior every week. And Jackie, I think your argument was the most convincing in that we don't actually see her drink on camera. I'd have to think these girls' lives are filmed not 24/7, but, you know, close to it. So if she was drinking, she couldn't hide from the cameras. So that is the only thing that's leading me to believe that it's just her personality, but I'm still pretty skeptical of that.
I don't know. I'm up for that segment because I'm going to defend her and just, you know, there's nothing wrong with a little craziness. It might not have been the best situation for, I think, out of anybody. Paul seemed the most annoyed, but it's entertaining for us.
Yeah.
Did you guys think he was rude?
Let's talk about Paul and Adrienne at the Kings game. I loved this segment because I love seeing these housewives, you know, in their business mode. You know, we don't really get to see that as much with the other Housewives franchises, or we do. I mean, I guess with Orange County, we saw, you know, Gretchen's makeup line and their fashion lines. And with Real Housewives, we see Ramona and Chill. But for some reason, I don't know, I respect the women of Real Housewives of Beverly Hills more. Like, I really respect Adrienne's business sense and wanting to be out there with the fans. I respect Lisa wanting to expand her business and her restaurant. And, you know, I loved this segment, seeing Adrienne be so attached and so committed. I mean, she was drawn to tears because of people shouting, you know, don't go, please stay. And she really, you could tell that it was really affecting her. And that was a side of Adrienne I really liked seeing.
See, I don't know, because I agree with you 100% that I like seeing these women getting things done. Even if they're not the hardest working women in the universe, at least they're putting effort and meaning into things in their lives, and you can tell they have it put together with Adrienne from to Lisa. You know, I definitely agree with you on that, Mari. What I'm going to say, though, about the Kings situation, which I wish wouldn't have happened, is it looked a little produced for me. Like, I wish that it would have seemed a little less fixed drama, where, like, the security guard was like, no, you can't go down, and then she's like, I'm going to go down, and then it was almost like they were looking for fans to sort of create the drama. I think it would have just been interesting in itself without having that little feeling of a producer hiding behind the whole scene. So that's my only call out, but I definitely applaud Adrienne, and I love seeing her in this vein, and it makes me admire her and these women, and, you know, gives them some clout that they actually do something.
Now, Jackie, before I get to you, I just want to clarify, Jackie, because when I watched that scene, I didn't think it was produced. I thought it was very genuine. She wanted to be down with the fans. And the most natural reaction of a bodyguard she employs is, okay, don't go down yet, or let's go down this way. So to me, that didn't seem produced. I'm trying to figure out what are the giveaways. I mean, you've obviously been on Bravo reality shows, so you know what is produced better than I would, but what about it seems so produced?
I think maybe it is my reality experience that's making me realize that. So I'm glad to hear that you didn't pick up on that, Mari. It's just for me, the way they captured the few fans and things like that, in the back of my mind, I know there's a producer behind there saying, okay, let's get this person, let's get that person. I think they need to give permission to be on the camera. So, you know, just the way they fixed that scene, and I part of me thinks that a producer would have said, let's have you go down there. I don't want to think that, but just my instincts tell me that. So, but you know what? I'm glad you didn't pick up on that. So maybe, you know, people who haven't been on the Bravo reality spectrum, you know, maybe it's just my experience getting to me here.
So, Jesse, what did you think?
Totally agree with you, Jackie. I was like, first of all, I know I've been to many games where people get rambunctious and whatnot on the show, but it was just like, there's a game going on. There's no way that these people are way more into the fact that they're here than the game that's happening right now. Somebody really like hit his ear. That was just, to me, that was just like, I don't know. It was kind of funny. And then the fact of like them sitting up in the booth where they probably always sit and probably hardly ever go down to the floor. And out of nowhere, she's like, I want to sit with the fans. The fans,
right.
The way the cameras were pulling it, the fans looked like they were rabid zombies and were going to rip your face apart. I want to be close to them. And then as soon as she goes down close to them, she's signing autographs, taking pictures. So it was a little funny to me, but I obviously don't. I haven't watched the show I didn't watch last season, so I don't really know how involved she is with, you know, the team and whatnot. So, but to me, that just, it did seem a little funny. Just a little bit.
I will say she is very involved with the business, just as involved as her brothers are, because a lot of people would assume that her brothers do most of the work in terms of, you know, the Palms and the team and the different businesses they have, you know, the Maloof empire. But from what I know and from what I've seen, she's equally as involved. But I wanted to talk to you guys about Camille and Camille this season. And I love, Jackie, that, you know, you asked her how she felt about her portrayal this season. And I think that the reason why she is happy with her portrayal this season is she really, before committing to a season two and deciding on, I think she's had a chat with producers, because we are seeing so little of Camille and only a certain side of Camille thus far in these episodes, that it makes me wonder. I mean, she was not in this episode at all, except for her preparing for her trip for Hawaii. And, you know, I love that she doesn't show her children in the show. You know, except for Kyle, I mean, Adrienne, we never see her kids. Lisa's kids are grown up. We haven't seen Kennedy at all, and I doubt we will now we know what's happened. But I like that on this Real Housewives, the kids are in it very little, if at all. But Camille, I have a feeling that she wants to make sure she's portrayed a certain way, that almost she's rarely in it at all. And, you know, I miss that. I miss the old Camille. So what did you guys think? You know, her segment was just about her Hawaii spring break, but what do you think of her this season?
I hear what you're saying about wanting to get more from her. You're right. It does seem like it's kind of like her way or the highway. She might have put a foot down, you know, and had an agenda as far as the way she wanted to be portrayed. But no matter what, I mean, I'm liking her this season, and I liked, you know, it's not as maybe as interesting as the drama side, but you know what? There's Brandi's came into this episode. There's tons, you know, with everything going on with Taylor, Lisa, there's so much going on that I'm still getting my dose of entertainment that way. And for Camille's sake, I definitely think it's the best thing for her. And after meeting her in person and being such a fan of hers, I'm happy with it. I'm happy that she's being portrayed in a good light because I like her.
And Jesse, what do you think? I mean, I know you didn't watch as much last season, but I mean, she's one of the main housewives. She was on it for what, 2 minutes, the entire episode?
You know, and it's funny because actually after meeting her and also watching, I've watched a couple different interviews with her. She really intrigues me as a person. And so I totally understand, Mari, like as far as you wanting her to be on screen. But One thing I kind of get from Camille is I think she's a very, very smart woman. And I think she's just been really, really affected by maybe not just the Kelsey thing that's happened in her life. But I think there's just so much underneath her skin that she's been through and that I don't think she can really hold it together for too long. And I think she's just taking that time and being on camera. It's a lot of pressure. You know, one thing I notice when she does a lot of like camera, like interviews, or she looks around a lot. You know, she always seems like nervous about like what she's saying or, and you know, how she says things. And I don't know if that's more recent or what, but I just think that she kind of wanted, I think she watched herself last season, was like, that's how I really was portrayed. And, you know, one thing I learned from the real world, the contracts these people sign are kind of crazy. The editors can really kind of tell their own story, you know, with the producers. And so I think she probably looked at last season was like, okay, this isn't happening. You know, I went through a lot of stuff last season, and, you know, let's pull my character back a little bit. You know, we'll represent, she's being represented as a mother. She, in her interview, the big thing was that she couldn't come to New York because she was taking care of her son, who was starting school at a new school. That was important to her. Another thing that was important to her this time was that they went on the ski, it was a ski trip, right? Or, no, I'm sorry, they went to Hawaii. You know, that was important to her. So she's being portrayed in this, like, she's about family. And I don't know if she was portrayed as that last year as much, more so than I know that she had a...
That's right. Well, Jackie, I don't know how much you can share, but, you know, you are going to be on an episode of a Bravo show, and you were telling me about the contracts and about portrayal, and almost, you know, in a first season of a show or one episode, you really do have to sign away whatever editors want to portray you as. So could you Absolutely. Tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, you definitely... I am going to be on an upcoming episode of a Bravo show that I will share more details as I get more details. But, you know, I can't talk about that one too much, but my past history with Project Runway on Bravo, you know, you definitely have to, not only do you have to sign that, you know, give up yourself as far as the way they portray you or capture you, but you actually also have to follow guidelines, and there's usually a monetary fine. You know, mine was upwards, something around, I can't quote myself because I don't have it in front of me, but it was like something like $1 million if I said, gave up show details or if I said the wrong thing. Now that's not an exact number, but it's an estimation. So it's not only that you agree to let them have total control, but you also face possible, you know, fines and monetary issues if you do the wrong thing or fight something or say the wrong thing. And not only that, but I even know for a fact that established people, actors, a famous singer that I know signed a contract with a reality program, even they, as established people in the industry, don't ever get those rights. So no matter what, when you sign on to these shows, no matter what level you are, how wealthy you are, who you are, you give these producers complete control. Otherwise, you just don't do it.
But yeah, actually, and I know you obviously can't talk about the episode yet that you're going to be on, but what I took away from our conversation is just, you know, producers can portray you in the way that they want, not necessarily in the person you really are. Like, it's a character that they want you to portray, not who you are.
Right, yes. For the upcoming show, I am featured in a pot, you know, like it's a real estate-based show. And I went into it not really knowing what to expect and sort of just innocent walking through an apartment, I'll say that much. And I received an email that they sort of developed my character and just needless to say, it was pretty interesting news to me, the way I'm due to be portrayed. Now, nothing has come out yet, and this is just all based on talk, but yes, definitely they shape, the producers do a good job of shaping you as a person, even if you don't realize you're going to come off a certain way.
Jesse, what do you think about all that?
Well, I actually want to, I mean, I definitely agree. I know it's true, as we said, you know, we'll be doing The Real World, and, you know, I've had many talks with Leroy from The Real World, and, you know, the things, and I've even read the 30-page contract MTV gives them, so I'm pretty sure that that's pretty much a standard, you know, contract. The first thing it said was, if you die, it's not our fault, and to me, going into something where, you know, which, you know, makes sense, but I don't know, reading the deforming of your name, and editors are allowed to create your storyline, like, it clearly says that in the contract, so that doesn't surprise me at all that Bravo has that. But one thing I wanted to ask you guys is, you know, we saw the incident with Taylor talking about how everyone who works for her has to sign a confidentiality.
Yes.
Now,
I mean, I thought that was totally, I mean, and I'm on Kyle's side. I thought that was, like, totally unexpected. I mean, I love Kyle. She's so genuine. She was like, I don't have that much staff working for me. I have a housekeeper, and I certainly don't make my housekeeper sign one. So I don't think necessarily every reality star has to have the people who know their personal life and the inner workings sign confidentiality agreements. I think in Taylor's case, she had something to hide. Obviously, she had something going on in her personal life that even the cameras weren't that privy to. And so that would be necessary for people to sign confidentiality agreements. I wouldn't be surprised if that was Russell's doing and not her own.
But so my question is, would Bravo make them do that? I mean, these people are in their lives. They're in their draws. They're literally, like, going through their personal things. Like, they take care of their houses. So technically, if, you know, Taylor didn't want something to be, you know, if Taylor wanted something to be spilled, or if someone wanted something to be spilled, it could go through one of those people, couldn't it? And so I wondered, how many people does Bravo make, how many people do Bravo make sign that contract?
I don't know that Bravo would necessarily hand out confidentiality agreements. I'm pretty sure that they wouldn't unless they're featured on the show. So I wouldn't think Bravo would be behind that. And if that were the case, then Kyle's staff or housekeeper would have to do that. I definitely think, I agree with you, Mari, that that might be have been Russell's doing or something of that nature. I certainly know of plenty of you know, celebrities and people that don't necessarily have their help sign these kinds of agreements. So that is pretty unusual, I think.
But I'm glad you brought that up, Jesse, because I thought the whole situation with Taylor and the gossip article was the most interesting thing this episode. And, you know, I have been uncomfortable the last couple episodes watching anything involving Russell and her marriage, but here I was just more intrigued than anything because it really was so interesting to me. I mean, basically, she is accusing one of the wives of leaking a story about her losing so much weight, and because Lisa is the one who maybe they're not the best of friends out of the whole cast, and Lisa is the one who the night of the cocktail party went up to her and said, I'm concerned about your weight. You need to put on your weight. Come over to my home. I'll take care of you. You know, Taylor automatically assumes it's her. But what I thought was totally obvious was everyone can see that Taylor's losing weight. You don't need a spy for that. Like, anyone on the street, any journalist, any photographer could take a picture, see she's losing weight, and it would be more than obvious for a story about, oh, she's losing weight because she's dealing with her marriage right now. So I think her accusing any of the wives of leaking that was uncalled for.
I totally agree with you, Mari. I think there are so many people out there that could leak a story. I mean, there's so many sources. For her to accuse somebody on the show, and obviously it would be, she's insinuating it's Lisa. I just think it's as inappropriate as whoever leaked whatever information of Taylor's. But Taylor doesn't know who did that. So until she knows, has proof or any kind of factual information about who would leak that, for her to accuse somebody like a Lisa character on national television like that, knowing she's being filmed, I know that obviously it's good for Bravo, it's good for drama, it's good for a storyline, but honestly, that to me is more inappropriate than the gossip article even being out. I mean, whoever did that, you hope it's not one of the housewives, but for her to accuse somebody on TV like that, I totally think that was out of line.
She's doing...
Well, you know what? The reason I think that she even accused one of the housewives was because Russell put the idea in her head. And this is a glimpse of Russell that was so interesting to see. She said, Russell and I decided I should not talk to my friends about my marriage. And Russell's furious. Who of your friends did this? It's like he put the idea in her head. He put the idea in her head, don't talk to your friends about our marriage. You know, it's seeing a side of him that she claims that she found her voice this season, yet it seemed like he was still controlling her. Jesse, what do you think?
I agree with both you guys. I think it was inappropriate. You're doing the same exact thing that you're blaming somebody else to do, of doing. You're putting gossip out there about somebody that you don't even know the answer to. And like, exactly like you said, Mari, like, you, honey, you look like a skeleton. You,
right.
It's clear. Hello. Like, no one has cheekbones like that. Like, you're, it really, if I didn't know her at the party, I would probably say something to her. You know, and not even that, but Lisa is one of my favorites on this show. I love everything about her. apparently they don't get along for some reason. But it just seems like in Lisa's nature, she works at a restaurant. She seems very like, darling. And so, of course, she's going to come over to someone and be like, honey, like, food is her life, technically, like, take parties and all that stuff. So I definitely didn't think it was out of her nature to say that to her, especially if they all know that she is going through something. I do hope it wasn't Lisa, because I really kind of do like her. But then again, could I see her being like saying to somebody like, I'm worried about her, you know what I mean, in a general sense, and then someone making an article about that. But I mean, for those details, I don't think anyone on the show really has time or feels like they have enough time in their life to go around gossiping in that sense.
Yeah, and given the time of when this episode was filmed, I'm pretty sure what she's referring to, I know there was a Star magazine cover of her, and they said, you know, wasting away, you know, a whole article about her not eating because of her marriage. And they showed a picture of her in a bikini on the cover, and that's what I'm saying. All they need for a story like that is one picture, and then they can build a story around it regardless of spies. And so that's why I think a picture is worth 1,000 words, not whatever Lisa is potentially saying to people. And, you know, Jesse, I'm glad to hear you defend Lisa, you know, pulling Taylor aside at the party. I absolutely love Lisa. I'm not sure if that was the best venue to do that. I don't think that you should pull someone aside at a party and say, you need to eat, you're too thin. You know, that might be something, I don't know, I guess they're not that good of friends, but also, so then if they're not that good of a friend, maybe Lisa should have told Kyle, hey, Kyle, you're close with Taylor. Why don't you say something to Taylor? Because, you know, I'm not close enough to her. She might take it as an attack, which she did. And so I think that might have been the better way to handle it. I love Lisa's intentions here. I just think the execution maybe wasn't the best, well thought out.
I just think that, I think Lisa was going in it very blindsided when she did it and from a caring place. But like you said, I mean, not even that it's the wrong place, because they may not you know what I mean? She may feel like, well, you know what, this is my only chance. Pull her aside. You said it in front of like three other people. And one of them was, her name is Dana. Who's the new girl?
Yes, Dana, Dana and Brandi.
Who, I love Dana as well. You said it in front of her and it was like, she is new. Like, maybe they have a connection or something, but don't do that in front
Dana
of
Dana and Taylor are friends. They were friends prior to the show.
Okay, you know,
Taylor brings Dana in and Adrienne brings Brandi in.
Okay. Even still, you don't do that. Not in front of other people. It's fine if you want to personally say it yourself. I understand where she came from in wanting to make sure she said it to her. That's kind of like, you know what, there's been drama between us, but I am worried about you. I want you to know I'm worried about you. I don't want it to go through somebody else. I want to tell you, and even if we're at this party, I still want to tell you because I want to make sure we have the time and the chance to do it. I'm not coming over your house. I may not get along with your husband. You know what I mean? Like, but not in front of other people. That's the only issue I had with Lisa doing that. There were two other people there.
Oh, I'm sorry, Jesse. All right, go ahead.
Oh, no, that was all I wanted to say.
Cut you off there. I was going to say, Mari, you're going to be happy because I'm definitely converting to more of a Lisa fan. I know I've compared her to the Countess of the Real Housewives of New York, and while I do think she has that slight condescending demeanor, I think she's made of completely different stuff than the Countess. I think she's totally on top of her stuff. She's got her stuff together in life, you know, the way she handles Sir and her restaurants and her taste level and the way she's just like above the BS. I mean, I don't think she puts on a front. I think she's just like, sees Taylor, knows she's too thin, doesn't even like her, but sees something wrong and is like, whatever, you're skinny, get your skinny ass over to my house and we'll sort this out, end of story. Like, I like that about her. And I do agree with you, Jesse, though, that she probably shouldn't have said that in front of other people. I'm okay with her saying it at a party because you're right, they may not have other points of contact, but I certainly, you know, I have to give her credit because I think she's above the bullshit and she's just like, let's do this, you know? You're skinny, something's wrong with you, I'm willing to help you. So I like that about her.
And I'm dying to talk about the new introductions we saw in last night's episode. Before we get to the quote-unquote friends of the wives, as they're calling Brandi and Dana, not official wives yet, I want to give a shout-out to my new favorite addition to the cast, who I hope to see more of him, is Kyle's lady sitter. I immediately started following him on Twitter, and I tweeted at him. I said, you're incredible. Please call into our show. He is so fabulous. And just for our viewers out there, a little clarification, Kyle tweeted, a lady sitter is a personal assistant with an attitude. So, lady sitter, if you are listening, please give us a call one of these weeks. We would love to chat. So I just had to give a little shout-out to him there. But let's get into the two introductions, that being Dana and Brandi. Dana, I'll be short and I'll be sweet. She didn't impress me last episode. I thought she was boring. I thought she very well could be the Cindy Barshoff of Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, Cindy being the Real Housewives of New York castmate that joined last season that was just a dud. So, Dana, I don't know you. I know, Jackie, you met her. I'm just saying she needs to bring more drama. She was boring last night. You know, there was, you know, not much of a story there. So that's my guess for now. Hopefully that'll change. What'd you guys think of Dana?
Well, I have to say, Jesse, I know you were there too and you met her. So I want to hear what you think. But in my opinion, here's what I think about Dana. I think she seemed like a nice person. I don't think she gets the Real Housewives game. I mean, I don't know. She's talking about $25,000 sunglasses next week, so I'm not sure what her background is or how wealthy she is or anything like that. But she just doesn't come off on the same level as these other housewives, which there's nothing wrong with that, but it just might not make for good television, like a Cindy Barshoff, who's probably a great businesswoman and a mom and all of these things. Sometimes it just doesn't translate to TV, and when I met her in person, I worried about that, and this episode, in fact, proves that. So I am worried for her sake if she's looking to use this show as a platform, because she definitely did not make any kind of impression as a character. Now, that's not to say she's not a smart, interesting person in real life, but sometimes it just doesn't translate. And I think Brandi definitely took all of the spotlight in this episode. And I saw them in an E! Interview as well last night, and same thing. Brandi and her were sitting there next to each other, and Brandi just, like, took over that interview. So Dana either needs to pump it up or know that she might not have much time on this show.
Jesse, I want to get your quick opinion on Dana before I talk about the new bitch in town, as I'll call her.
Oh, and I'm glad you called her that, because, first of all, I actually like Dana. I like her because of all the reasons you guys aren't liking her. As far as turning it up, I hope she turns it up, but in a different way. I kind of almost want her to bring a little bit of hardness and realness to the show. I don't know if she's intimidated by the women and their money. So I would like to know a little bit about her background. Apparently, something goes wild in Vegas with her. So, well, you know, I guess we will get a story out of her. But I don't know. I'm the person, I watch these shows, and if I see too much of the same thing, it kind of bores me. You know, so, you know, I like people like Kyle. You know, as extravagant as Lisa is, seeing her, like, at the restaurant, how much she really cared, like, I loved that, you know? That's what really, like, got me to fully enjoy her as one of my favorites on there. And again, like you said, Jackie, just the, you know, I'm above the BS. And I'm kind of hoping that's where Dana is. I'm kind of hoping, like, you know, I'm not involving myself with this. You know, I'll have my time when I want my time. And I feel like she's going to be the one who's going to be, she's going to be in the scenes with Taylor. She's going to be in the scenes with Camille. She's going to get herself in the places, because she's going to be the neutral bot. And as I've seen in other reality shows, the neutral bot is cool, but there will be a time for that neutral spot. You'll have to pick a side. And so I'm kind of interested to see where that will take her.
And, you know, it seems like even Bravo is kind of agreeing with us that Dana is not going to be the one to watch, whereas Brandi will be, because Bravo tweeted right before the episode aired last night, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills is on now, and we've got a new girl in town, ! Tune in. So they said a new girl in town, not new girls in town, they said a new girl, that being Brandi. So even the fact that they're, you know, focusing in on Brandi as the new girl in town as opposed to Dana seems to say that they agree with me. And, I mean, who wouldn't agree that Brandi is the new girl in town? I tweeted last night, Brandi Glanville came in guns blazing. She is going to be drama for the show, and I can't wait. I loved her quotes. Her very first one on the show, she said, I was married to the number one douchebag of all time. He's a, quote, actor. I love it. It's hysterical. Obviously, all our fans probably know this, but she is the ex-wife of Eddie Cibrian, who left her for Leanne Rimes. And she is a B-I-T-C-H, and I can't wait. What do you guys think of Brandi?
I totally agree. This is where I say, if I want to be friends with someone or interact with someone in person, it'd probably be Dana, but who do I want to watch on TV on this show, because that's what it stands for, is someone like Brandi. I mean, she is, like, you're right, that one line, I have to just say that my boyfriend was over my shoulder, and he's not really, you know, the type to watch these kinds of shows, but he heard that line, and it actually made him laugh and, like, watch the next couple minutes of the show. So I definitely think she makes a statement. She gives these girls a challenge, and, you know, she's upping the game here on Beverly Hills. And I think Paul definitely called it out, Adrienne's husband, and said, you know, in Beverly Hills, younger and prettier women are met with jealousy and hostility. I don't know that she's necessarily prettier than some of the other women. She might be younger, but I think just that sort of cattiness and jealousy and everything that comes out, the claws come out, I just think it's it's definitely entertaining to watch. I would like them to stand for a better message, like you said, Jesse. I hope Dana might be able to do that. But I definitely found her very entertaining and a good addition to the show.
Yeah, she's interesting. She irks me. She really irks me. And why do you think he left you? Why do you think he left you? I'm sorry, but
snap.
You can see through people so easily, and it's just like she was so transparent in this show. Her little act of like, I'm in it. Like, I don't understand why Lisa's talking to me. Lisa's a bulldog. I love her. This woman walked up to this little girl and said, oh, you know, she had her little coffee chat at the beginning, introduced herself. She wasn't going to be rude or anything. But then she went straight to the point. She said, do you know him? And she said, you know, I don't make that my defining. You make Eddie, what's his name, your defining claim? So why wouldn't you make the next guy? And then she said, oh, I didn't, you know, he never mentioned anything of you. Well, he never mentioned anything of you in your relationship. Well, clearly he did. The way you just stated that, yes, he did. And now you know that that's why she's coming up to you. You knew why she was coming up to you from the moment you shook hands with her. You knew it. And to sit there and play the game, I get it. It's the Housewives game. Totally understand. And she's going in there, and I know she's going in there cocky with, I'm the youngest, I'm fabulous myself, and these old women are not going to be able to compete with me. So I think that's what's going to, she's going to keep these women on their toes. But yeah, ooh, bitch.
I know. When she said, how old is she? 60. She needs to let it go, move on. I was like, geez, she is a bitch. But I have to say, while I applaud Lisa for asking her about Cedric, you know, I think that Lisa, what happened with Cedric, she's very genuine about it. I felt so bad for her when she was like, you know, I hope that he doesn't dupe another idiot like me. You know, it was sad. And so I applaud Lisa's effort. Yet I think that Kyle, though I love her, was kind of a bitch herself last night. I mean, Brandi didn't even really say anything. All she said was, we modeled together 15 years ago. And Kyle was fighting Lisa's battle and being so catty and talking behind her back, right as she's standing there. And, you know, I really thought that was bitchy, though she did tweet last night, you know, because people were tweeting at her, you know, you were being a bully. And she said, I do cringe watching the last part with Brandi. I really was joking around, but still wasn't good. And, you know, she also was talking about how, I know I was a little catty with Brandi. I'm feeling a little protective of Lisa, and I'm not perfect. So I applaud her for recognizing that she was being a bully. What did you guys think?
I have to agree. I usually love the realness of Kyle. And as a woman, I think it gets the best of you. Any woman, no matter how admirable or real or whatever, girls just gossip. I mean, it happens. So I'm sure she regrets it, and I do think it was not her best moment. But I'm going to give her a bit of a pass because I normally really like Kyle, and I think she's really real. So I am going to give her a bit of a pass, though it did not look good on her end.
I mean, I'm from the world of gays, so to me that's like a natural conversation they were having. So, I mean, yes, with the whole realness of her, but I think in that moment, like she said, she was reaching off of Lisa's feelings. She knew how genuine Lisa felt about him, and it was just, I think, you know, in the moment, I'm going to make this comment. It's going to cheer my friend up. It's going to put her in a better place. She doesn't know her. She doesn't care to know her. You know, why? I know thousands of people. I don't need to get to know this woman. Did it come off bitchy? Yes. Should people be harassing her on Twitter about it? Absolutely not. people, get over it. It was a comment. They could be best friends next episode. And Kyle could say what she said to her face. You never know. But the end of the story is, please, everybody who decided to make a comment on Twitter, please tell me you've never sat down someplace, looked at somebody across the way, and made a judgmental comment about them. We've all done it. It wasn't out of the blue. She was doing it for a friend. And as much as it was like seemed like she was right there, I'm sure they were across the ways, you know. So I didn't take it as offensively.
I'm with you on that, Jesse. You're right. Like, it's not like she was like holding her hand and acting like her best friend or anything. So there was nothing really fake about it. It just probably wasn't the best, most mature way to handle it. But you're right. We all do it. So come on. Who cares? It's not that big of a deal.
Right.
Well, why don't we go to a quick commercial break before I get into our new segment, share all the tweets that the fans are tweeting about the show and last night's episode, and some news and gossip.
Want to find out what the AfterBuzz is about?
Janice is a drama queen.
This is the divide that is going to carry the series.
Give us a call. 424-256-1729.
424-256-1729.
This television, and they want it to be as dramatic as possible.
I mean, it's Shakespearean.
You never know what goes on behind closed doors.
Find out why AfterBuzz TV is the number one source for after-show content.
Now, in the eyes of Jimmy, Nucky is a villain.
424-256-1729. 424-256-1729.
I mean, who would you guys rather hear that from? Your husband or your best friend?
The wig!
The wig will come out.
When the TV show is over, get your AfterBuzz on. AfterBuzz TV News.
Okay, so in our news and gossip, I mentioned this last week. Camille said she has a new boyfriend. Now we know more details. He is a Dallas-based lawyer. I'm totally going to mess up his name. It's Greek, so Jesse, hopefully you can help me. It's Dimitri George Charalambopoulos. Definitely Greek. And I don't know if you guys saw the picture of him, but she said he's easy on the eyes. I agree. He debuted their romance on September 19th at Lisa's birthday party, and she said, I really take months to work on myself. You think you'll never find love again. I couldn't imagine having those feelings again. Friends kept saying it would happen, and a year later, it did. So, good news for Camille and Dimitri.
I think that's great for her, and definitely that last name is a mouthful. but I'm happy to hear that she's moving on. I'm totally a Camille fan, so I'm very happy for that.
Agreed. And once you go Greek, there ain't no turning back. So. forget Kelsey.
Taylor, apparently Bravo has decided they are going to air footage of Taylor and Russell's marriage counseling sessions. It'll start airing in the next few weeks. A story says Bravo has done major editing of the show to be sensitive to the fact that Russell committed suicide. However, the decision was made to air the footage of the therapy session. Viewers will see the two of them with their marriage counselor, Dr. Charles Sothi, as well as individual sessions with Taylor. However, Russell's one-on-one sessions will not air. Taylor is completely supportive of this decision, the source says, and thinks it will help battered women to make the decision to leave an abusive relationship just like she did. I don't know if I agree with that. I think Taylor's one-on-one sessions should be aired. I still don't know how I'm going to react when I see Russell himself on screen. I'm not sure if I've been uncomfortable even hearing people discuss him. Seeing him on television, I think, will make me and many fans incredibly uncomfortable, especially in a vulnerable position like a therapy session.
I totally agree, Mari. I think there's a time and a place, and there's a certain moral level that you just shouldn't show footage of somebody who just committed suicide on a show. I just don't think it's the right time, if ever. now is certainly not the right time. It's too fresh.
I think they're going to touch upon his death in this season. I think they're just building it up to that. And agreed, I don't, you know, as much as it didn't really affect me because I never watched the first season. Watching the interviews, hearing the talk about it, you have to become sensitive of it. And I don't want to see that, you know, being new to this. Like, I don't know. Like, I don't know what their relationship was. Maybe Russell was a bad guy. Apparently, that's what they're painting him as, this mysterious guy who was bad. And now he, you know, committed suicide. And if you're going to show it, then I think then you need to show all of it if you want to show it. But if you're not, you know, if you want to be sensitive to it, then don't show it at all. Just show her stuff, you know, because then it's like you're telling her story. You're showing what you're going to show, the clips of them arguing together in the sessions. But then who knows what was said on his behalf, you know, like what problems he was having, what issues he was having. And if you're going to go that way, then I think that his words should be said, you know, in that sense of it. But I just think it totally should be scraped. I don't think that they should play it. I hope they don't go into the suicide, maybe not talking about it on the show, but talking about that he did pass. I don't want that to happen. You know, come back next season and just assume we already know. It's uncomfortable.
Yeah. Well, on a lighter note, I know this is a rough transition from talking about an uncomfortable topic like that, but on a lighter note, our favorite Lisa, it's been revealed that she was an 80s music video star. At the age of 22, she appeared in the music video for the song Poison Arrow by ABC. It was released in 1982. DJ Jesse, I would love for you to play it for our fans so we can get a little glimpse of Lisa here.
If I want to say to you, can you keep a secret? Would you know just what to do?
She would be in this music video. It is just
so
like
80s.
It is, and it's just fabulous and glamorous, and definitely, I mean, check it out, guys. Poison Arrow, Lisa Vanderpump. It's just fabulous.
Oh my god, so hilarious. Honestly, everything Lisa does is amazing. And I want to end our show before we get into our predictions by sharing some of the fans' tweets. We got to get a little audio, you know, a little like tweet going. But I want to share, apparently, Jesse, some people on Twitter share your opinion. Dawn Chalk now tweeted, after watching Real Housewives, I get why Eddie dumped Brandi Glanville. You get what you give. Guess that's why everyone treats her so poorly. So, Jesse, you're not the only one thinking that. Ronald Richards tweeted, The Real Housewives is a pretentious, fictitious, and embarrassing portrayal of aging women of plasticity who do not represent Beverly Hills. Ronald, I have to disagree with you. I'm from Beverly Hills. I love the majority of the women on this show, and Lisa, Kyle, Adrienne, I think they're all good portrayals of what goes on in Beverly Hills. And apparently, Sia Furler tweeted, oh my God, Kim is being so narcissistic tonight on Real Housewives. I guess Sia says narcissistic, I say alcoholic, but each your own. And Patty, a.k.a. Bravo Liberty One, retweeted, Lisa Vanderpump was being totally genuine and generous in offering her help to Taylor. That is a good heart. And that was tweeted by Bronzo. I agree with you, Bronzo. So those are some of the tweets. You guys, tweet me at MFagel, tweet at AfterBuzzTV, or tweet my co-host, Jackie Mirann. And please let us know your thoughts, and we'll share them on the air. And why don't we get into some predictions?
And now,
Your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
It looks like to me we'll be seeing more of Dana and Brandi. Jackie, you mentioned Dana's comment about the $25,000 sunglasses. We saw Brandi get into it with Taylor a little bit on the divorce, and Taylor's saga seems to continue. What do you guys think, you know, about next episode and what's going to happen?
Well, I definitely think Dana is going to be portrayed in a bigger light than her first episode. So I'm going to find out more about her. I'm looking forward to that after meeting her in person. Hopefully we can get her to come on the show at one point to give us some inside track. And Brandi seems to keep on bringing it, so I'm looking forward to all of it. The two new housewives are definitely piquing my interest still.
I want to see Lisa and Brandi get into it. I just want to see Lisa put a little puppy in her place. yeah, and I don't know, I'm kind of over the Taylor Russell stuff. It's just, it's strange. It's just very strange to watch. I'd like to see more of Kyle. I'd like Kyle and Dana to be friends, like really like build a friendship. I think they would be really fun together. I'd like to see them do like a trip or something with each other, or I think that that's somebody who could kind of loosen Dana up a little bit. And then I hope we see more Camille.
Well, I hope to see more of Camille too. So that's it for our after show. And thank you for joining us all. You can catch us again next week on Ustream and iTunes at our regular time, which is 8:30 Tuesday night. And thanks for listening, everyone. Have a good day.
From producers Kevin Undergaro and Phil Svitek, engineer DJ Jesse Janity, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. If you have questions or comments, be sure to buzz us at info@AfterBuzzTV.com. And you can find us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter by searching for AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.